On June 28, 2009, Honduran President Manuel Zelaya was kidnapped by the military and left in his pajamas at an airport in Costa Rica. The military and police took control of the streets to repress the mass movement that demanded both Zelaya's return and the progressive changes he was pushing for in the country. 20 months later, and the military are still deployed, perhaps nowhere more visibly than the Aguan Valley. The region has become a key battleground between farmers with little or no land, known as campesinos, and wealthy landowners backed by military and police. The price of basic foodstuffs has doubled since the 2009 coup, and campesinos have ramped up a long-held tradition of occupying unused land or land in the hands of the country's richest people. A recent study found that there are roughly 300,000 Honduran families in need of land. Meanwhile, the majority of the land in Honduras's fertile Aguan region is in the hands of three men, all supporters of the coup, who are using Honduras's richest soil to produce palm oil for export. This is the community of Orica, where one of the groups of campesinos that organized after the coup are now planting corn and radishes on land they occupied 7 months ago.
Solo ganaba 60 lempiras, 50 lempiras, lo máximo. Porque el rico lo que quiere es que nosotros le demos el pulmón, los hagamos viejos, trabajándole a él y nunca nosotros prosperemos. Nuestra familia siempre sufriendo.
Teníamos que recuperar lo que era nuestro y muchos compañeros, yo los felicito que a través del golpe de Estado ellos han, sacaron esa venda de los ojos y estamos en la lucha.
Nosotros tenemos un derecho que es la tierra y la tierra nosotros la ocupamos para trabajarla.
The government of Manuel Zelaya, just weeks before it was overthrown in 2009, agreed to grant land titles to some of the campesino groups in the region. In November 2010, the military occupied the region's National Land Reform Institute, a government ministry charged with distributing land to campesinos. Staff were forced to leave, and the military held the building for 2 months. During that same period, while the entire region was militarized, security guards of Miguel Facuse, the richest man in Honduras, ambushed and killed five campesinos working land they've held for more than 10 years. Miguel Ramirez survived the massacre, despite being shot in the face with a high-caliber machine gun.
Aunque hubieron cinco muertos nuestros compañeros, que lo sentimos mucho, causa una lucha de pobreza. Para mantener nuestra familia, para que las personas que miren o escuchen este video, que entiendan todo lo que está sucediendo aquí en nuestro país, que es una lucha de pobres y estamos contra unos monstruos.
Facuse later admitted on national television that the killers were indeed his guards, but placed the blame for the deaths on the government's land reform office for having given land titles to the campesinos in the first place. More than 2 months have passed since his admission, and there is no criminal investigation of Facuse for the November killings, or any of the 14 campesino murders that Honduras's Committee for Human Rights have blamed on Facuse specifically. Meanwhile, Honduras's Chamber of Industry recently awarded Facuse for, quote, his continued investment despite the country's instability. He spoke to Honduras's El Heraldo newspaper.
Necesitamos del capital extranjero para que venga. Pero estos asuntos, como están sucediendo en el Aguan, donde están robando, robándole iniciativas privadas al sector de inversiones, le da mala espina.
For Ramirez, these events confirm his belief that the country needs fundamental change, and he sees the People's National Resistance Front, which formed in response to the coup in 2009, as the means to get it done.
Tenemos que sacar adelante este país con la resistencia. Es la única esperanza. Y gracias que el país hoy ha despertado.
On February 26, the National Popular Resistance Front had its first truly national assembly. 1,500 delegates participated, representing each of the country's 298 municipalities, after local assemblies like this one in the town of Sabá were held nationwide to elect delegates and debate the future of a movement most people simply refer to as the resistance. The movement is unified by its call for a new constitution to replace the one written in 1982 under US-backed military dictatorship. It is also unified in its rejection of the current regime of Pepe Lobo, who took power in elections held under a coup government, with the military occupying the streets during a national boycott by all who opposed the coup, and with zero international observation and ample proof of fraud. Nonetheless, the elections were recognized by the United States, Canada, and a few others. And since the United States represents at least 60% of Honduras's international trade, their recognition alone was enough for Lobo to take office. The position of the U.S. is that Lobo represents an end of the political crisis, but as president, Lobo has rewarded those who led the coup and repressed those who opposed it. General Romeo Vasquez Velasquez was the head of the military that carried out both the coup and the repression of the movement that rose up in resistance. Lobo named Vasquez president of the country's state telephone company. WikiLeaks has since released a cable sent by U.S. Ambassador to Honduras, Hugo Llorens, to the State Department and to headquarters in Washington, reporting that Lobo was considering appointing General Vasquez as his Minister of Defense, but changed his mind after the U.S. Ambassador advised him that it wouldn't look good internationally. Meanwhile, the political leader of the coup, Roberto Micheletti, has been rewarded with Honduras' first ever seat as a congressman for life. The Lobo regime is also upholding an amnesty law that forbids the legal prosecution of Vasquez, Micheletti, or anyone else who was involved in the coup. This impunity for the powerful sectors is a daily reality in post-coup Honduras, where dozens of political assassinations, including 10 journalists in 2010 alone, along with illegal detentions, kidnappings, torture, and accusations of gross corruption, are all left unpunished and largely uninvestigated. The resistance's National Assembly began with a tribute to those assassinated since the coup. Author Melissa Cardosa covered the assembly for local radio station Radio Gualcho. She says the murders helped unify groups like the campesinos who previously struggled alone.
Las que hemos estado en la resistencia y nos enfrentamos con la represión nos dimos cuenta de que los enemigos de este pueblo pues nos quieren asesinar. No por casualidad hay una gran cantidad de personas asesinadas, mártires de la resistencia. Creo que eso provocó un elemento muy importante para este país y para otros países. El hecho de que las luchas de grupos que se han aglutinado, ya sea por gremio, por partido, por identidad, el golpe, la represión, nos sacó a dialogar entre nosotros.
Han habido como unas 21 muertes campesinas, ya agarrando el poder Porfirio Lobo Sosa.
Juan Chinchilla is a member of the Unified Campesino Movement of Aguan, one of the many campesino groups currently occupying and working the land of the region.
Donde hemos sido militarizados dos veces ya de este año que pasó, con 7,500 soldados en cada militar.
In February, Rigoberto Funes was shot dead while driving home mid-afternoon. He was the president of the Campesino Cooperative Prieta and a local leader of the resistance. Also killed was the cooperative's treasurer, Freddy Gonzalez Castro. The police immediately declared the attack a robbery, but Chinchilla doesn't agree.
Sabemos, verdad, que ellos quieren hacer una nube de humo para taparlo a nivel nacional que fue un robo. Los compañeros fueron fuertemente asesinados donde fue en una carretera panamericana donde hay mucho tráfico a plena luz del día y que quede los casos impunes, eso también no lo vamos a dejar.
As for Chinchilla himself, in January he was kidnapped for more than 24 hours, where he was beaten and tortured with an open flame before narrowly escaping. 2 months later, and he and his companions are still receiving regular threats, such as this text message sent to his good friend Jorge. Not even Chinchilla can save you. We know you're in Tegucigalpa, and we will find you and your little one when you guys are all alone.
Y tenemos una presión constante. Entonces, a lo que cabe a mi persona, después de todo lo que me ha pasado, y estoy aquí, es porque sí, yo sí estoy convencido y tengo la convicción de refundar a mi país. Y lo sigo diciendo, si esta gente me quiere quitar la vida, la voy a dar por hacer cambios en mi país, sí lo voy a hacer.
But the countryside isn't the only battleground where the resistance is fighting. In the next segment, we look at the battle over public education that's raging in Honduras' cities and highways. Reporting from Honduras for The Real News Network, I'm Jesse Freestone.